Tēnā koutou katoa, ko George Parker, tuku ingoa. It is my really great pleasure to welcome you here this evening to the session of Te Tiriti-based futures and anti-racism, titled Indigenous Sexualities and Colonial Ideologies. We're going to have a really amazing hour together with two incredible guest speakers who I will have the pleasure of introducing shortly. But first, Clive, I wondered if I could invite you, please, to open our session with a karakia.
Tēnā koe, George. Tēnā koutou katoa. Nau mai haere mai tātou ki tō tātou karakia. Kia taunamanaakitanga a te mea ngaro. Ki runga ki tēnā o tātou. Kia mahia te pua mākihikihi. Kia toi te kupu, toi te mana, toi te aroha, toi te reo Māori. Kia tūturu, ka whakamaua, kia tina, tina, huie, tāraikia.
Kia ora, Clive. Thank you so much. Big warm welcome. Hope you're settling in out there. I was so honoured to be asked to chair this session by my dear friend and colleague, Associate Professor Clive Aspin, who is such an important person in Aotearoa, progressing equity and justice for our rainbow communities, our takatāpui communities, and for Māori. So, thank you so much for having me here for a session that could not be more current if it tried. In many ways, unfortunately, because of some of the backlash we're experiencing around sexualities in Aotearoa. I am a senior lecturer in health services delivery in the School of Health at Te Herenga Waka, and yeah, it's my great pleasure to be here. We just have a couple of housekeeping slides that we want to take you through. The first is to just mention our community code. If you've been coming to multiple sessions in this incredible online conference, this will be familiar to you. But if you could just take a brief moment to have a look at the code. One other notice is just our accessibility info. If that relates to your access to the event, here, just we'll leave that slide up for a moment for you to be able to process that. So, in terms of the format of where we're travelling over the next hour together, what we're going to first do is I have the great privilege to introduce the panel speakers today. We'll then be inviting each of them to kōrero with us for about 10 minutes each, up to about 10 minutes each, about the different pathways they have into this topic today. After that, we'll be opening up for what we hope will be a really awesome dialogue and discussion with you out there as our webinar attendees. So, as you're listening to the presentations and it's provoking thought and response in you, feel free to put questions that you have for our presenters in the Q&A app on Zoom. I don't even know where my lingo. We'll work through those once we get to the Q&A session, but we will have those presentations first. With no further ado, I will introduce our speakers today. So we have the incredible Ataria Sharman. Big warm welcome to you, Ataria. Ataria Sharman, Ngāpuhi, Tapu Ika, is a writer and editor. Ataria has a Master of Arts and spent a year researching mana wahine and atua wahine and interviewing Māori women about their experiences with atua wahine. Ataria is the creator of Awa Wahine, a platform dedicated to celebrating and promoting the voices of wahine Māori. Huia published her children's novel, Hine and the Tūhanga Portal, in 2021, a finalist in the 2022 New Zealand Book Awards for Youth and Children. And when I heard that Ataria was part of this panel, I had a full-blown fan person moment. So delighted to have you here with us, Ataria. I'll introduce Clive and then I'll be handing over to you. Thank you. Associate Professor Clive Aspin. I have to be right out there and say he's a dear, treasured friend and colleague of mine. So again, I was so privileged to have this opportunity to welcome and host Clive in this panel. Clive is Ngāti Maru, Ngāti Whanaunga, Ngāti Tamatera, and is the inaugural Associate Dean Māori in the Faculty of Health at Te Herenga Waka, Victoria University of Wellington, where he is also Associate Professor in Health. Clive was born in Waiuku and grew up on his ancestral land of Hauraki. Dr. Aspin is a Māori public health researcher whose work focuses on Māori and Indigenous health, HIV, sexuality, and suicide prevention. He was the executive research officer at Ngāpai Te Maramatanga, New Zealand Centre of Māori Research Excellence. He served as a ministerial appointment to the Board of the Health Research Council and is chair of the Māori Health Research Committee. He is a founding member of the International Indigenous Working Group on HIV and AIDS. Clive's contribution to public health, both here and internationally, has been profound, and we were all very delighted to have Clive recognised last year as the 2023 recipient of the Te Rangi Heroa Medal awarded by the Royal Society Te Aparangi. So, a big warm welcome to you both, Clive and Ataria. I'm going to hand over to Ataria first to invite you to talk with us for about the next 10 minutes. Really excited to hear what you've got to say, Ataria. Thank you.
Awesome. Kia ora koutou. He rea hau no ngā puhi tapuika, ko Ngāti Kura, ko Ngāti Maruku ki ringa hapu, ko te tāpui, ko te pāmu, ngā marae, ko Atari Sham tōku ingoa. Thank you so much, George, for the lovely introductions, and also Clive for doing our karakia for today. So, yeah, for my karakia, oh, kōrero today, I'll talk a bit about my upbringing, my research that I did for my master's, and my thoughts on reframing our thinking on sexuality, the body, and reproductive systems. If I sound a bit breathless or if I disappear during the Zoom, it's because I'm actually heavily pregnant and may need to use the whareiti, and there's like quite a bit of pressure on my lungs, which I'm sure all our māmā out there will definitely know when you're coming into the end of your haputanga. Anyway, so going back in time to when I was a teenager, growing up in a mostly Pākehā environment and schooling, I realized that later on in life that I actually had a really negative perception of being a woman, my body, sex, and relationships. For example, I tried to strap down my breasts so that people couldn't see them, which is actually hard because it runs in the family quite well endowed. Thought my periods were the biggest pain ever. Hid when I was having sexual relationships from my parents. And sometimes what felt like it would be better to be a man because it seemed easier and cooler to be in society in that way. So instead of seeing, oh, another one was instead of seeing haputanga or pregnancy as carrying on the whakapapa of the whānau, hapū, and iwi, a sacred journey from te kore to te ao marama, back then I just wasn't really keen because being a mother seemed like a lot of hard work and the birth process sounded like super painful and sore. So, so that was kind of where I started off back then, if I go back in time. Where did it all change for me? So I read Ngā Huiamurthy's master's thesis, Te Awa Atua, Menstruation in the Pre-Colonial Māori World, which I highly recommend, and all her other books, as well as The Balance Destroyed, also a master's thesis by Ani Mikaire, which led to a huge realization for me. I realized that my thinking since childhood about being a woman, perhaps even birth, was colonial, mainly European thought influenced, possibly by Christian teachings. Basically, that pre-colonial Māori likely did not think of these things like I had been. The consciousness of this fact meant that I could start decolonizing my thinking on being a woman, being a wahine Māori. In 2019, I completed my master's thesis on mana wahine and the ata wahine. I had the privilege of reading about the ata wahine for a year and also having kōrero with Māori women about their experiences. Part of the reason for doing this was that I actually didn't know much about the Atawahine myself, and it was a way for me to re-claim that mātauranga as a wahine Māori for myself, and then perhaps also share it for like-minded others. So what we can be pretty sure of is there was no introduced European thought in pre-colonial Māori societies. There was no existence of the Bible or Victorian moral code associated with family values and sexual repression. There were no missionaries spreading the theologies of Christianity and no British soldiers or system of law to enforce colonization and its patriarchal roots. But some of the things that we did have were the pūrākau of our atua and the atua wahine as part of a cosmology of a Māori spiritual belief system, stories of superwomen who birthed gods like Papatūānuku, guarded over our past loved ones, Hine Nui Te Pō, recited karakia in childbirth and avenged wrongdoings, Hine Te Iwa Iwa, among many others. Retellings of these narratives vary, as they should, among iwi, hapu and whānau, but what is common, I think, is their awesomeness and also their often inherent sexuality as well. So what I'm trying to say is that before colonization, it's entirely possible that the way in which many Māori perceived sexuality, our bodies and reproductive systems were completely different, perhaps in a way that someone like myself who grew up in a mostly Pākehā environment may struggle to comprehend. I was privileged to kōrero with the late esteemed tohunga, Hine Wairangi Kohu Morgan, for my research interviews. And she shared her view that colonization had changed how sex was perceived. One of the things that she said in our kōrero was the idea of making love was not a thing. We didn't make love. We did what our bodies were naturally to do. And guess what? We did it anywhere because it was normal. It was as normal as it was to eat or drink. For me, that was really powerful kōrero. And it was really interesting to consider that the idea of making love, and in public even, could be of the same normalness as me taking a drink from my cup of tea right now, or eating. And it also demonstrated to me how far my own thinking was from that perspective. So how did this happen? How did my thinking get so far from this? In a quote from Jenkins, Western civilization, when it arrived on Aotearoa's shore, did not allow its womenfolk power at all. They were merely chattels, in some cases less worthy than the men's horses. What the colonizer found was a land of noble savages narrating stories of the wonder of women. Their myths and beliefs had to be reshaped and retold. And in a summary of the literature documenting Māori culture from the time period of 1920 to 1940, Dr. Aroha Yates-Smith considered there to be strong evidence of Eurocentric and Judeo-Christian bias, which when describing the Māori goddesses means that negative qualities were sometimes accorded. Dr. Yates-Smith also described meeting Māori women who had heard on the marae and read in books that only the atua tāne existed. So in my thesis, I suggest that fear of women's spirituality or power in Europe, which was actually around the time of Captain Cook still. He lived 1728 to 1779, likely influenced how the Atua Wahine and Wahine Māori were written in early writings by the Pākehā ethnographers. To provide context, you know, up until 1750, thousands had been executed across Europe for the crime of witchcraft. Obviously, these all point to a framing of the atua wahine and by association wahine Māori, because that was the focus of my thesis, which is why I'm talking from this perspective. But it is my opinion that colonial influences have permeated all aspects of the way we might think about sexuality. It is my perspective that if we hold negative moral codes and judgments about our gender fluidity, sexual relationships, and those of others, this could be a hangover of a colonial past, and we can choose to unlearn and reframe our thinking on these kaupapa. So now I'm going to share some examples of opposite thinking to that of my younger self, who is quite negative, clearly, which can be found in pūrākau, and I also did discuss in my thesis as well. So during childbirth, the woman goes through the nights of te pō. Her whare tangata becomes the threshold between te pō and te ao, te ao marama, and therefore the role of women as the bearers of past, present, and future generations is of the utmost importance. So quite different to my perspective on hapūtanga back then. In another narrative, ue poto, child of rangi and papa, escapes from the parental embrace of ranginui and papatūānuku through the urine of papatūānuku. And upon escaping through the waters of papatūānuku and seeing the world, ue poto returns to the entrance of papatūānuku. And for me, one of the things this demonstrates is the sacredness of the urine of papatūānuku. And another one, when Hinata Iwa Iwa's husband's whale, Tutunui, is eaten by a visiting tohunga named Kai. She and Raukatauri, Raukatamea, Iti Iti Reka Reka, Tuahaua Tangaroa, and other unnamed women travel to find him. And upon arriving, they use the ruse of entertainment to identify Kai by his overlapping missing tooth by performing dances of a sexually explicit and humorous nature, including a haka. These are just a few awesome examples, I think, of pūrākau affirming the status of sexuality, reproductive functions, and also wahine Māori. But looking forward, and this wasn't what I researched, but looking forward, I think an excellent space for future research is takatāpuitanga, including gender fluidity, which I'll talk a little bit about. So Dr. Elizabeth Kerekere, who I'm sure a lot of people here have probably heard of, and her groundbreaking PhD on takatāpui identity highlights that fluid sexual intimacy and gender expression existed among Māori in pre-colonial and post-contact time and has continued ever since, and it was accepted without punishment. And for Kerekere, what a really important thing about uncovering and promoting the narratives of our tupuna takatāpui, because our atu and our tupuna provide really great role models for us, and provide essential role models to support takatāpui resilience in encountering discrimination. And one role model, which I'm pretty sure Kerekere mentions in the thesis, is Tūtane Kai and his hoa takatāpui, known as Tiki, in a telling of the pūrākau by Ngāhuia Te Awe Kōtuku of the well-known Te Aroa love story of Hinemoa and Tūtane Kai. Another way we can explore different ways of thinking about sexuality, I think one of the best ways is creativity and art. And in 2022, the augmented reality installation Atua, created by Tanu Gagor and Jermaine Dean of FAFSWAG, claimed space for Indigenous queerness through te kore, the void, the potentiality, which I think is really exciting. And in Atua, te kore manifested as a digital being in an interactive AR visual space that brought together the cultural, spiritual, and physical realms. And I'm just going to read an excerpt from a review of this installation by Chanel Lau, which can be found on the Pantograph Punch. So from an intergalactic portal appears te kore, a cosmological sculpture embodying the universe's origin. Te kore is adorned with Indigenous markings. Te kore wears stars on their face to tell the story of voyagers who use the skies to navigate to the shores of the Moana. Their shoulders carry a solar flare eclipse, and their chest recounts the movement of the tides. The sound of thunder and strong ocean waves accompanies the arrival of te kore creating a feeling of mighty chaos, wielding the power of a revolution. Te kore, the void, draws an analogy from the livelihoods of Indigenous queer people. Before the Europeans brought the unholy pairing of Christianity and colonisation into our lands in the Moana, queer people were integral to the survival of Indigenous populations. Colonisation stripped Indigenous people of their rich queer identities and conditioned them with homophobia, transphobia, and queerphobia. So, so that really beautiful installation. And I think that an exploration of Te Kore is a great space for someone to look into for further research. To conclude my kōrero, I believe, that's my perspective, that there is much evidence that shows that pre-colonial Māori attitudes towards gender, sexuality, and relationships differed from European thinking, and that one by one, in removing moral codes and judgment from our own thinking of our own bodies, reproductive systems, and sexual relationships, that we powerfully enforce our right to the sovereignty of our minds and thoughts on these kaupapa. Yeah. So, that's me. That's my kōrero. And, thank you so much, everyone who's here. And I'll pass it back to George.
Ah, kia ora, Ataria. Far out. That was a phenomenal powerhouse amount of ground you covered in that short and really impactful kōrero. Thank you so much. A really skillful way that you wove your own personal accounts and reflections with scholarly insight and knowledge to demonstrate so clearly that the task of decolonization as the pathway to sexual and reproductive justice and liberation, that's a really important and timely challenge. Thank you so much. Really looking forward to being able to open up the space for dialogue and questions with you once we've heard from Associate Professor Aspin. As you're listening to the presentations, just another encouragement to make some notes and to start to document some questions so that we can come back to those after we've heard from Associate Professor Aspin, who I will be really glad to hand over to next. Just a gentle content warning because of the nature of Clive's life and work, there will be some mention of suicide in his presentation. If you need to step back for any reason during that, we will completely understand. My great honour to now introduce Associate Professor Clive Aspin. Over to you, Clive.
Tēnā koe, George. Nā mihi nui ki a koe I tēnei pō. Ki a koe hoki Ataria, ka nui te mihi atu nei ki a koe I tēnei rā. He mihi tino nui ki a tātou, kua taimai nei ki tēnei wānanga. Nā mihi tino nui ki a tātou katoa. He uri tēnei no Parihauraki, ko Moihau rawa, ko Te Aroa nā Maunga, ko Waihau rawa, ko Piako nā Aua, ko Ngāti Maru, Ngāti Kunauna, Ngāti Tamakarana, iwi tēnā koutou. I want to start my talk tonight by acknowledging the many awesome friends who have supported and loved me throughout my life, especially in relation to my work in this space. These are but three of those people, Glynis, Georgina, and Bunny, who are no longer with us. I love this photo because, if nothing else, it shows how good Māori are at colour coordinating at party, our party clothes. This photo was taken at the launch of a book I helped edit, Sexuality and the Voices of Indigenous Peoples, which is due to be republished in the near future. And these people, my friends, turned up without any consultation, and here they are looking beautiful in their finery. When we reflect on the process of colonization of Indigenous peoples, we know that colonization provided endless opportunities for white men to seek sexual pleasures with native men and women. With white men, they saw endless opportunities with white men. For white men, they were to seek sexual pleasure with native women, men and women. With these activities contributing to the expansion of the empire, the installation of heteropatriarchy, and the suppression of indigenous knowledge. Sexual activities between the colonizer and the colonized have generally been described by men, and as a consequence, scant regard is given to the pleasure experienced by women, people from sexual minorities, and indigenous people themselves. Instead, there is an underlying assumption that pleasure was experienced in the same way by all people, regardless of their gender, sexuality, or indigeneity, with this informing the way historical and contemporary Indigenous sexualities are often described. In this brief talk, I will discuss concepts of sexuality and pleasure that prevailed at the time of colonial expansion, and discuss how these were manipulated to establish a white middle-class society which mirrored that of the metropole. As a counter to this hegemonic view of sexuality, I will draw on historical and contemporary understandings of Māori sexuality to demonstrate that ancestral concepts of sex and pleasure were vastly different from those that were transported from the other side of the world. As this image here demonstrates, the so-called New World was portrayed as a paradise where European men could pursue pleasure free from the constraints of the colonial power. Indigenous peoples were portrayed both as available to satisfy the appetites of white men and as sexually avaricious. Indigenous peoples were seen as being in need of the civilizing influences of the West on the one hand, and as available to satisfy the sexual appetites of the colonizer on the other. In this way, the colonizer justified their conquest of the New World, so-called New World, and their desire to possess and control. The land was described as unspoiled and pristine, and its peoples were described as both sexually available and in need of civilization. The image of virginity was frequently applied to land in order to justify conquest and taming by white men and the subsequent expansion of colonial domination. Indigenous women in particular were described by commentators as Eve-like and innocent. However, others portrayed them as people with huge and uncontrollable sexual appetites. These views represented the two extremes within a range of descriptions of Indigenous women, but the overwhelming purpose of these descriptions was to justify the need to conquer and possess Indigenous peoples, and ultimately to encourage and justify the very process of colonization. Galleries around the world are full of images such as the one here. Scenes of horrific violence perpetrated against Indigenous people remind us of the devastation wrought by rapacious colonizers and the extent to which the wealth of colonial powers today is built on the backs of Indigenous people and enslaved people. Throughout history, religion has been at the forefront of the oppression of Indigenous peoples, with sex and sexuality being central components of that oppression. Christian missionaries pried into the most intimate parts of people's lives in order to transform and oppress Indigenous peoples. In the case of the Catholic Church, the rite of confession was a key plank in efforts to reshape the sexual lives of Indigenous peoples. A confessional manual that was used in South America encouraged priests to ask questions such as, "Have you touched the private parts or the breasts of some other part of the body, or kissing or embracing your wife or your mistress or a woman relative of yours or of your wife? Have you polluted yourself or did you have an ejaculation?" Women were asked questions such as, "Have you agreed to men sleeping with you utilizing other than your natural vessel, i.e. vagina? And have you kissed the private parts of a man? And have you agreed that he may kiss yours, enjoying this very much?" These were actual questions that priests put to Indigenous people. With the arrival of missionaries and moralists, Indigenous people were led to believe that sexual activities that gave pleasure were sinful and to be avoided. The colonial expansion in Aotearoa was spearheaded by mariners such as Abel Tasman and James Cook, who were sent by their governments to explore the vast expanses of the Pacific Ocean. These voyages led to meetings between Indigenous peoples and rapacious sailors. In the southern part of the ocean, pleasure and sexual gratification were fundamental components of the first encounters between Māori and the sailors who arrived on the first ships to visit this country. The pursuit of pleasure in particular played a key role in exploits of Europeans who sought to tame and control the lands of the Pacific and the people who inhabited them. After months at sea without the company of women, English sailors, according to accounts provided by anthropologist Anne Salmon, arrived with one thing in mind. As she describes it, Captain Cook's ships were transformed into floating brothels as his men set about seeking frequent and regular sexual contact with Māori women and girls. The men pursued the women on shore and enticed them onto the ships, often in exchange for commodities that Māori wanted, such as nails and articles of clothing. At that time, nails were highly prized by Māori, not as materials for construction, but as tools for carving. Artisans were eager to acquire these tools for use in the creation of artworks, and it is reasonable to believe that women and girls, either willingly or unwillingly, would have been solicited as accomplices to pry these commodities away from the sailors. With the advent of nails and the generation of Māori, the generation of Māori art was radically transformed, with sex work and pleasure playing a key role in their evolution. These early encounters were not confined to European men and women and Māori women. There is considerable evidence to indicate that European men also pursued opportunities for sexual pleasure with Māori men and boys. Archival material provide insights into sexual behaviour between the missionaries and Māori men, and in particular, they demonstrate how sex and pleasure were experienced by Indigenous peoples and the colonisers alike. Chris Brickell's work, his account of the trials and tribulations of William Yate, the man here on the right, a missionary who came to New Zealand in the early 1800s, provides some insights into how same-sex pleasure was experienced by Māori. Both Brickell and Judith Binney have described how Reverend William Yate, who lived among Māori of Waimate in the north, became proficient in the Māori language, and they used this knowledge to play a key role in the translation of religious documents. But from archival material held in the Mitchell Library in Sydney, New South Wales, we know now that this proficiency in Te Reo Māori also served another purpose. Thanks to his expertise in Te Reo Māori, Reverend Yate was able to ingratiate himself with local Māori and in the process establish close relationships with young Māori men, some of whom entered into sexual relationships with him. On some occasions, Yate provided these men with tobacco and trinkets, but from all accounts, it seems that the men visited Yate of their own volition. As one man, Tohi, said, "I cannot count how many times I went to him." According to an account provided by another missionary, William Williams, as many as 50 to 100 men were sexually involved with Yate. If nothing else, the experiences of Mr. Yate with young Māori men suggest that same-sex relationships were accepted and condoned within Māori society in the early days of colonisation. Ironically, it was due to the efforts of Mr. Yate's colleagues and the churches to which they belonged that Māori attitudes towards sex and sexuality were distorted and suppressed, so that Māori sexuality would eventually come to mirror those of the coloniser. Under the colonising influence of the new arrivals, great efforts were made to subvert the processes that Māori had used for generations to record the rich diversity of relationships that existed in Māori society. Numerous examples exist of carvings being mutilated, with offending genitals being removed in order to satisfy the prudish gaze of the coloniser. Museums in New Zealand are full of examples of emasculated male figures with scars that now replace penises. Artworks that depict same-sex relationships were destroyed, or more fortunately, removed from New Zealand and taken to the other side of the world, where they could satisfy the eyes of the curious onlooker in museums. And here we have a close-up of a waharoa that was desecrated, and that this now sits in the museum in Auckland. Greedy, avaricious colonizers invested much time and energy in acquiring our artworks and treasures. Many of them reside in museums across Europe. Some of these remain intact and provide historical evidence of the existence of same-sex relationships as well as people who enjoyed multiple relationships. Artworks fell into the hands of collectors, and today these languish in dim, dusty museums on the other side of the world. These examples are from Cook's third voyage to New Zealand, and today they sit at the end of a dim corridor in the Museum of Anthropology in Florence, Italy, where they are inappropriately displayed and protected by glass and a sign saying no photos. This image here shows barge boards, shows the ridge bone of a whare inappropriately placed to show the man on top of the woman in a true Eurocentric way. As Indigenous peoples, we draw significant strength from the knowledge that our ancestors lived in locations where sexual diversity was celebrated and where notions of pleasure and desire were integral components of our sexual lives. While sex for purposes of procreation were essential to the ongoing viability and vitality of Indigenous communities, it is important to acknowledge that sexual pleasure and desire were equally important components of the day-to-day lives of our ancestors. As Te Rangi Hiroa has noted in his description of pre-European Māori society, adults discussed sex matters quite openly as an ordinary topic of conversation and without the pruriency which accompanies such topics among some other people. Children listened unchecked, and by the time they reached adolescence, they had little need of the instruction which European parents often fear to give their own children. Sex experience was regarded as normal, and the theory of wrongdoing and sin was not present until after European contact. Some political leaders, such as our current Deputy Prime Minister, are fond of quoting Te Rangi Hiroa, or Sir Peter Buck, as he prefers to call him, when he rants against people who differ from his narrow view of the world. He would do well, in my view, to read Te Rangi Hiroa's work in its entirety, not in a selective manner, as he is wont to do. Today, we live with the legacy of colonial ideologies that have been imposed since the beginning, since the signing of Te Tiriti o Waitangi. He iwi tahi tātou is the phrase we hear constantly, as if to say we are all the same, but clearly we are not. Our whānau, many of our whānau have been adversely impacted by these colonial ideologies. And we cannot forget that the pain and hurt inflicted by the agents of these ideologies continues today. When writing about the AIDS pandemic and its impact on our communities, Edmund White wrote this: I thought that never had a group been placed on such a rapid cycle, oppressed in the 50s, freed in the 60s, exalted in the 70s, and wiped out in the 80s. Around the world and in Aotearoa, here in our country, the AIDS pandemic has adversely affected people who are ostracized and marginalized because of their sexuality. Men who have sex with men, sex workers, people who use drugs, Indigenous peoples. This slide that you can see here contains the names of all the people I know who have died from an AIDS-related illness. Many of these names are Māori. Our escalating rates of mental health, unwellness, including suicide, have adversely affected people who identify as lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, intersex, etc. A significant number of the names that you see here are Māori. A significant number is also members of the LGBT community. I want to finish my talk by acknowledging the wonderful role models I've known in my life, people like Carmen, who lived a life of honesty, love, and compassion. There may well be people here today who knew Carmen. Like me, they will know that she was a pioneer in claiming the right to live her life freely and openly as a transgender woman. We can be inspired by people like Carmen when we think of the attacks on transgender people today. In Parliament last night, Grant Robertson, in his valedictory speech, called for the rights of transgender people to be recognised. And this morning we heard about how poetry readings by drag queens in the Rotorua library are being cancelled after 7 years because of the threats of violence from a so-called Christian church. It is frightening to think that these threats against LGBT plus people and transgender people in particular are becoming increasingly prevalent around the world and here in our own country. The tapestry of human sexuality is diverse and glamorous. We need only look to our ancestors to know where the origins of our glamour lie, and that we have every right to stand tall in that knowledge. And finally, next time you visit a marae and a whare tupuna, look around you and see how many of our whakaero celebrate the diversity of Māori sexuality, such as this piece here from my papa marae on the left, and the one on the right from Ngātai Whetu Marae at Kōpū in Hauraki. Ko tēnei, te mutunga tēnei o tōku kōrero, nāhi nui ki a koutou katoa, tēnā. Got it, George.
Tēnā koe, Clive. Thank you so much for your incredibly powerful kōrero. I don't know that anyone can distill that much history with that much accessibility in such a short time frame as you can. What you traced powerfully demonstrated the ways in which sexual repression and in particular queer and trans oppression is a legacy of colonization, and therefore queer and trans liberation must center the process of decolonization. So thank you for that incredibly important and timely challenge, and for bringing it straight into the present moment with all of the backlash that all of our communities are facing. There's been some beautiful commentary coming through in the chat. A real acknowledgement of the glamour that you have both brought to this webinar at a tricky time of day. So thank you to all of you who have joined us at this dinner hour. What's dinner hour in my house? Share these incredibly convergent but diverse kōrero about Indigenous sexualities and colonial ideologies. This is a really perfect moment to open up for some questions, although I wanted to first invite Ataria and Clive to kind of respond to each other if there was anything pressing that you had. You haven't really had an opportunity to do that. So is there anything that either of you wanted to jump in with first?
I just want to say how wonderful it was listening to Ataria and hearing a contemporary voice talking about sexuality and what you have uncovered in terms of our history. So, and it resonates, really resonates with work that I've done and readings that I've come across some decades ago. So it's tremendous to see that there is an increasing understanding of the reality of sexual diversity within Māori communities. Thank you very much.
Oh, well, thank you, Clive. And I guess for me, like listening to your kōrero, there was actually a lot that I didn't know. And from up here in Ngāpuhi, I have heard stories of the women with the settlers. And I feel like that's actually a space for more, it would be a really cool way to really get to the bottom of what was happening in places maybe like Kororarika, in terms of those relationships between the settlers, Tāne Māori, Wahine Māori. So yeah, anyway, that was just super interesting. And I really loved how we obviously approach topic from different ways, but it worked in really well together, which, I think that was really cool. So.
Yeah, that's good.
Kia ora. Well, I'll jump into our Q&A box and offer up some questions. I might direct them at one or the other of you, but please both feel free to jump in. The first one I wanted to pose was directed at you, Clive, that you mentioned the violence of the churches towards LGBTQA plus communities. Are there churches that are standing against this violence that you're aware of?
Yeah, I'm sure there are. I hope there are. Yeah, I'm sure there are. Look, the forms of extremism that we see from some churches, and I don't even really want to say their name here, the forms of extremism are frightening, and it's appalling to think that people who claim to follow a peace lover such as Jesus think it's okay to perpetrate violence on people like us. It's unimaginable. And hopefully there are churches that are pushing back against them. And I'm sure there are. But I don't know them off the top of my head.
Yep.
Maybe
Kia ora
people here
koe.
do.
Aye. Ataria, did you have any response to that? No, you're good. And there's a great one here for both of you, which I'll offer up again for the Q&A, and then I'm going to jump in with one of my own because I'm the chair, so I get to do that. There were many stories of Māori with multiple partners, and this person is posing, asking your thoughts on whether you think monogamy in relational context was a practice of te ao Māori or not.
So I've been reading what Te Rangi Hiroa has to say about this, and while marriage was important and sanctioned, there was also the liberty and the freedom for people to explore sexual behaviour before getting married. But so marriage was considered sacred, and once two people entered into a marriage relationship, their sexual behaviour was confined to that context. But experience, well, but there were opportunities also for young people to have sex outside marriage, and there seemed to be no judgment cast against people as we see commonly taking place today. So I think people were, and that piece that I quoted from Te Rangi Hiroa indicated that young people grew up with this knowledge that sex was a normal part of our life and our important aspect of our well-being. There's a
Ataria?
question about Māori men, about interactions between settlers and Pākehā men, between Pākehā men and Māori, and there's a lot of archival material in Australia and that talks about the interactions between missionaries and Māori, because Reverend Yeate was tried in a court in Australia, in Sydney, for his transgressions, and he was finally expelled back to England. And there's a very rich source of data about the trial that took place around him, with witness statements from people back here in New Zealand.
Ataria, did you have anything to add to that idea of monogamy and te ao Māori?
I think that it would have been much more like what Clive was saying, much more, this is my personal opinion, much more open and flexible. And I think we can see this in some of our stories of rangatira who have multiple marriages. And I wonder whether, obviously that kōrero has been noted down. So, but I think, like, if we think of leaders and role models, then that models to everyone else that these behaviors are okay. So, yeah, I think that for me, I would say that monogamy was much less important. And I guess it would have been up to the individual to decide, and there would have been variations between iwi and hapu and whānau based on how they might feel about that. But definitely I don't think it would have been like how it is now, where it's almost prescribed and you will be judged by a kind of moral code. I don't think that. Yeah, that's just my opinion. Kia
Yeah, I
ora.
agree. I think you've hit the nail on the head there, Ataria.
Ataria, I have a background in midwifery, and so I had a question. I noticed your in your personal account of your earlier life, that sense of the negative stories surrounding birthing, and I wondered how you think we make space for decolonizing and indigenizing birthing in Aotearoa, when birthing still so firmly in the stronghold of hospitalization and Western medicine. Do you have anything to offer
Yeah,
there?
no, I do. I feel so grateful because my generation are lucky enough, and up here in Whangarei, Northland, where I live, and I know this is in other areas as well, wahine Māori have set up hapu wānanga
Hi.
for wahine Māori, and the way they're done is completely different to antenatal classes. We actually start with going through the creation story. So it's not anything to do with the birth itself or labor. It's like the pūrākau, you know, from te kore, and we go, and you go through all of them, right through to te ao marama. And I just, and we, what else do we do? We make muka ties. So we were weaving from flax. They brought flax in. And we also make ipu whenua with the clay, which you can put the placenta in after the birth and bury. So I just have to say I feel so appreciative and grateful to the women who probably didn't have that opportunity to learn about those things, and they've set it up for those of us who are a bit younger to then come through. And I mean, I've heard kōrero of women who weren't allowed to take the placenta from the hospital, because back then it wasn't a thing in the colonial hospital system. That doesn't mean there's not still challenges, but I'm so grateful for our hapu wānanga that we have around Aotearoa, and I think that's the space to start to for decolonizing the way we think about earth and haputanga.
Kia ora, Ataria. Did you want to add anything there, Clive? No, you're good. Another question from the Q&A box, Tēnā koe kōrua. Can you comment on how you think the kōrero around the proposed Treaty Principles Bill may affect Pākehā and Indigenous conceptions of LGBTQ plus rights? I think we've got you on mute, Clive.
Te Tiriti guarantees us protection of all our taonga, of our diversity. And in my view, and I'm sure in the view of our ancestors who signed Te Tiriti, that included sexual diversity. So protection of that diversity is really fundamental to what was agreed on February the 6th, 1840. We need to ensure that that continues to be protected, but sadly, it's not. We do have new laws in place. I grew up never imagining that it would be okay for two men to marry or two women to marry. But we've seen significant progress, and we just need to make sure that that continues. And when our political leaders make negative, politicized comments about transgender people in particular, we need to worry significantly, because those, by making those comments, they are leading to further ostracism and marginalisation of people who are members of our whānau. And my belief is there's room for all of us. And I believe also that the Te Tiriti guaranteed, or when it was originally signed, it was with the intention that the diversity and the beauty of a Māori society be preserved and protected.
Beautiful. Thanks, Clive. But Tadia, did you want to add to that at all?
No, I don't feel like I know enough about it, like the kōrero around that too. Yeah.
The questions are coming. Sorry, are you jumping, Clive?
I was just going to say another point. So Māori society is not unique in terms of recognising the importance of sexual diversity. When we look at other Indigenous peoples around the world, sexual diversity before colonization was part and parcel of those societies. So we're not unique in that sense.
Right. Yeah, the questions are coming hard and fast. How are you doing, my two awesome speakers? We've cool. got about 4 minutes, maybe one more, and then we'll start to wrap up. I'm going to jump up to one right at the start that I never got back to. What your thoughts are about queerness in te ao Māori pre-colonisation? Either of you want to jump in?
So, go on, you go, Ataria, and then I'll go.
Okay, so it's not saying I've heavily researched myself, but if I fall back on the, you know, kōrero of Dr. Kerekere, you know, her findings are that there wasn't the discrimination, and that it was, that fluid sexual intimacy, takatāpuitanga, it was there in pre-colonial Māori and continues now. And there weren't the punishments that we see now. So that's my perspective on it.
Yeah, I agree. I think we wouldn't have, words change all the time. But queerness for me in this modern era suggests diversity and a rich tapestry. And I believe that in pre-colonization society, communities and among Indigenous people, there was the same diversity. And takatāpui was part and parcel of that. I was glad you raised that, Ataria.
And would either of you have any guidance to offer for those who are takatāpui of how to work towards encouraging acceptance within their own whānau, hapū and iwi? And we'll have that be our last question this evening.
I think there's always one person who can provide support to people who might be questioning their identity. It might be an auntie, it might be a grandmother. I know in my case, my grandmother was particularly loving. We never talked about my sexuality, but she was really loving and kind. And I think grandparents have this amazing innate ability to provide support for young people who might be questioning who they are and where they fit into their whānau. So seek out that person. It might be a school teacher. It might be an auntie. It might be a favourite auntie. It might be some friend. There's always one person out there, at least one person, and often many more, who are there to provide support, care and love and acceptance. And I think we are living in a more accepting world than the one in which I grew up. But even despite all the barriers and difficulties, there is always one person who will embrace you and throw a quarter wine of love around you if you are questioning and thinking about big issues like identity and your place in the world.
Beautiful. Kia ora, Clive. That's an amazing place to leave our questions. Did you have anything else you wanted to jump in and add there, Ataria? I love that idea of sending everyone who's joined our webinar out today back to their places and spaces and communities with that same korowai of love. That's a beautiful offering. Thank you, Clive. Any last words, Ataria and Clive, before I invite you to close us with karakia, Clive?
I just want to say thank you so much, everyone who came along. Thank you, George, for being an amazing chair. And it's a real privilege to kōrero alongside you, Clive. So,
Well, beautiful. Thank you to Ataria. It was wonderful being on the same platform as you. And many people here don't know, but I'm going to tell them, I used to work with Ataria's father. So it's so wonderful to be here with his daughter. Ataria's father was the person to help me get access to my very first laptop computer 30 years ago. So it was a big, heavy one. So Ataria, thank you. It's been great sharing this platform with you. And George, you've been a wonderful chair. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really appreciate your great support. So
thank you both.
Ngā koutou, nō mai, ki tō tātou karakia whakamutunga. Unehia, unehia, unehia ki tō uru tapanu. Ke wātia, ke māma, te ngā koutou tīngana. Wairua aratangita, koeira e rongo, te kairea a te kūrunga ki a tīnā, tīnā, huie, aki. Kia ora tātou.
Kia ora, Clive. Take care, everyone. Thank you so much. Go well into your evenings. Big thank you to the sponsors of this incredible online community that is happening. There are many of you. We won't name you all specifically, but many, many thanks for all of that support out there. And just a wee shout out for an amazing event happening tomorrow.